My name is Hilton Hammond, and welcome to the Fluke presentation on ABCs of portable oscilloscopes. This training presentation is intended to cover the basics of portable scopes. It's aimed at those users who are familiar with multimeters and are now faced with troubleshooting devices or systems that need more than amplitude or volts, ohms, and amps measurements. The training will cover the fundamentals of how oscilloscopes operate, go over the key functions you will need to know, and then we'll get into how to capture a waveform. We'll also explore techniques and tips how to analyze a waveform to identify potential areas of problems. Lastly, we'll spend some time teaching how to use some of the tools found in modern-day portable oscilloscopes that allow you to capture the most difficult of problems, those being intermittent or random events. We'll divide the training into three modules. First, we'll cover the basic theory of how oscilloscopes work, spending some time focusing on key functions you'll need to know that will make it easy for you to set up an oscilloscope. Second, we'll go through the 3 to 4 basic steps of how to capture a waveform, then break the waveform down into key elements so that we can, from a qualitative perspective, analyze an unknown waveform. Lastly, we'll review the tricks and techniques of how to capture random events or intermittent signal phenomena. These are the issues that keep technicians up all night. Electrophenomena can be measured in three domains: amplitude, the y-axis, time, the x-axis, and frequency, the z-axis. A multimeter measures precise amplitude measurements. A spectrum analyzer measures signal's amplitude relative to frequency. An oscilloscope measures the signal's amplitude relative to time. In the electrical world, there are many signals that purposely vary amplitude over time, typically to control some process further downstream. Then there are the cases where the amplitude should remain constant, but for a variety of reasons it does not. In both cases, an oscilloscope is used to analyze the integrity of signal's amplitude over time. Let's start with understanding the basic principles of a multimeter. A typical digital multimeter will use a dual-slope integrating analog-to-digital converter, or ADC. Basically, the ADC works by first applying the unknown input to an integrating capacitor circuit, much like filling up a storage tank with some liquid. The unknown signal is applied to the circuit for an exact known amount of time, usually from milliseconds to as much as a second. Next, the circuit will discharge the capacitor using a reference voltage of opposite polarity until it reaches 0 volts. The discharge time is precisely measured by a microprocessor clock. The time it takes to discharge the capacitor is directly proportional to the unknown input signal level. The longer the integration or deintegration time, the higher the resolution and the greater the accuracy. An oscilloscope will plot a signal's amplitude change over time, the amplitude being on the vertical axis measured in volts per division. The horizontal axis timescale is in seconds per division, with a time resolution as low as nanoseconds per division, or down to the billionths of a second per division. Therefore, from a timescale perspective, the oscilloscope can capture and display amplitude changes with a resolution of nanoseconds per division, to as much as minutes or even hours across the display screen. In order to digitize a signal at that speed, the ADC used in an oscilloscope work very differently to that found in a precision multimeter. In general, although not all, scopes will use a multiple comparators arranged in parallel, where the unknown sample is applied to all comparators at once. Then each comparator will compare the unknown input to a reference voltage. The comparator that finds a match to a reference voltage will raise a digital bit or flag, thereby letting the microprocessor know that the unknown voltage is at that precise moment in time. The advantage of this technique is the conversion speed. The disadvantage is in the resolution and thereby overall measurement accuracy. The scope's vertical accuracy is around 1.5%. compared to a basic 3.5-digit multimeter being less than 0.15%. While a digital multimeter provides very accurate, high-resolution measurements, The oscilloscope adds the second dimension of time. Plotting amplitude and time will provide several additional benefits to analyzing or troubleshooting. A scope will provide, firstly, amplitude information, where the peak-to-peak, a peak, RMS, or even amplitude at a very specific points of interest can be measured. Next, time information, where the signal period or frequency, either time from start point or next, time between two different signals and various other time-related measurements. It also provides wave shape information, where you can visually inspect the overall quality of the waveform shape, like that of sine, square, pulse, or even complex waveforms like video signals, digital communication signals, and many others. Lastly, it also gives you a sense of the signal quality, where you can check for aspects like distortion or disturbances. We'll go into signal detail on analyzing waveforms later, but beyond amplitude information, the oscilloscope provides three additional variables to troubleshoot signals, those being time, shape, and quality. Here's a quick overview of a digital oscilloscope's architecture. This will familiarize you with the key functions that control the acquisition and display of a waveform trace. The block diagram shows how the unknown signal is passed through a series of signal conditioning circuits. These circuits control the coupling, attenuation, amplification, gain, such that the unknown signal applied to the A-D converter is within known limits. For differential measurement, some oscilloscopes include channel-to-channel isolation. Once conditioned, the signal is sampled and converted to known digital amplitude values, then stored into memory. With the sample stored in memory, we can now manipulate the data by calibrating the data points, or performing math, and eventually displaying traces on screen. AC coupling will display only the AC portion of a signal centered around the zero voltage point. With AC coupling on, DC offset present in the signal will not be displayed. If you're not sure, toggle the coupling on then off to see if the signal contains any DC offset that is important to you. In some cases, you will start with DC coupling on, for example, looking at a DC voltage from the output of a regulator. Then once you have checked the DC level, you will turn on AC coupling, then increase the vertical sensitivity to look for any AC noise component present on the signal. Amplitude range controls the gain or attenuation of the input amplifiers. It is used to scale the unknown input onto the display. Sometimes you will increase the sensitivity, zooming into a signal looking for imperfections, say along the rising edge of a pulse waveform. Watch out that you don't increase the sensitivity such that the trace extends beyond the display top or bottom edges. You could inadvertently cause the input amplifiers to saturate, giving the appearance the waveform is distorted. As we have already discussed, an oscilloscope uses high-speed analog-to-digital conversion technique to sample the unknown input signal, the objective being to digitize the unknown waveform as fast as possible. The faster the sample rate, the higher the horizontal sample resolution. Some errors can occur due to undersampling the waveform. First, aliasing. Say, for example, if you only sample a sine wave once or twice per period, the resultant displayed waveform will look very different to the original sine wave, perhaps more like a triangular wave. Transients or glitches will go undetected. Reduction in display frequency or bandwidth. These potentially impacting the level of noise displayed, for example, on the DC supply. To minimize these errors and reproduce the waveform on a display, the oscilloscope objective is to sample the unknown input as fast as possible, of course, within a reasonable cost. A key aspect of digital storage oscilloscopes we must consider is the sample rate versus memory depth and its impact on the acquisition process. Consider, for example, an oscilloscope with a sample rate of 1 gigasample per second, or 1 billion times per second. At a time-based setting of 100 milliseconds per division, with 10 divisions or a total display time of 1 second across the screen, sampling at 1 billion times per second, the oscilloscope would require 1 billion points of memory. Due to cost and memory write speeds, this is not really practical. Therefore, for example, an oscilloscope with 1000 point memory, the sample interval is reduced to 1000 samples per second, or a sample rate of 1 kilosample per second. Glitch detect is a technique used to overcome the two critical errors with digital ADCs, that being aliasing and missing glitches and transients. In some oscilloscopes, the glitch detector is essentially a secondary ADC running continuously, buffering sample points in memory that allow the microprocessor to capture all the minimum and maximum sample values over time. Since the scope only stores and uses the minimum and maximum points, we limit the amount of memory needed but still capture any transients and oversample the unknown signal, preventing displaying of an aliased waveform. One of the most important specifications of an oscilloscope is bandwidth. Like the human ear, electronic equipment like oscilloscopes have limits beyond which they can no longer hear the signal very well. Imagine you went for a hearing test. You put on a pair of headphones and the technicians adjust the volume of a test signal so you can hear it clearly. Next, they slowly increase the frequency or pitch of the signal without changing the volume. At some point, your ears will tell you that the volume has decreased. As the frequency gets higher still, you will eventually be unable to hear it at all. The frequency at which the scope indicates that the input has decreased in amplitude by about 30%, 3 dB, is called its bandwidth. Essentially, the bandwidth is a way to measure the performance of the electronic circuitry inside the scope. Think of triggering as a sequential acquisition of photo snapshots printed on a clear transparencies. Once each picture or transparency is placed on top of the other, a complete picture can be built. Without synchronizing the position of the pictures, the images would look distorted. With the triggered waveform, the display becomes stable and clearly visible. The oscilloscope uses several techniques to trigger or synchronize the display. With edge triggering, as the detected voltage rises or falls through the specified voltage level, the trigger circuit fires the display process. With pulse width triggering, once both the voltage level and predetermined time interval conditions are met, the trigger fires the display refresh process. This makes it possible to synchronize on very specific pulses in a stream of pulses. Connect and View is a Fluke ScopeMeter proprietary algorithm that automatically and continuously analyzes the unknown signal to adjust the scope vertical, horizontal, and trigger settings for a stable display. It virtually eliminates the need for continual hand-holding and adjusting scope controls at every test point or measurement. Connect and View will capture an unknown waveform without having to know anything about the waveform amplitude, time, or triggering dynamics. It will always provide you a good starting point to work with. The trace display update can be controlled. The typical choices are continuous or free run, which updates the display regardless of the trigger condition. A live trace can be seen even with no input signal. This is the ScopeMeter's default condition. On trigger, refreshes only when a valid trigger condition occurs. Otherwise, the trace will freeze, waiting for a valid trigger to occur before updating or refreshing the display. This mode typically provides the fastest display refresh or update rate. Single shot is a great tool for capturing once-off, never-to-be-repeated events. Firstly, set up the vertical, horizontal sensitivity, then arm the scope with single-shot trigger. Once the trigger condition is met, the scope will update then freeze, allowing you to analyze the event for as long as needed. The scope will require the trigger to be manually rearmed in order to acquire another waveform and update the display. The Fluke ScopeMeter test tool includes insulated BNC input connectors and isolated power adapters that provide a safe means to float the oscilloscope input above earth ground. Both input channel A reference and channel B references are isolated from earth ground. On some Fluke ScopeMeter models, like the 190C series or 220 series, the input A reference and input B reference are also electrically isolated from each other, making it possible to perform differential measurements without the need for an external differential amplifier or specialized accessory. A typical bench oscilloscope input reference and chassis are electrically tied to earth ground to protect against electrical shock. To be safe, all exposed metal conductors, including the chassis and BNC connectors, are tied to earth ground. Connecting the bench scope reference input directly to anything other than earth ground can present an unsafe hazardous condition to the user. A bench scope input channel references cannot be connected to two different voltages. Furthermore, the reference points must be connected to earth ground at the circuit under test. Otherwise, you could inadvertently create a short circuit condition through the mains earth ground connection. The ScopeMeter 120 series input references are tied together, while the 190 series or 220 series input references are electrically isolated, providing the optimum solution for troubleshooting differential signals. Again, with the Fluke ScopeMeter, the reference point can be connected to the voltage other than earth ground safely floating the oscilloscope. Make sure you read through the user instructions and ensure you understand the instruction specifications and safety warnings. This concludes part A. Be sure to continue on to part B.